Everybody. Well, is everybody ready for the Grinch? All right, we're going to have a great evening. My name's Alan Potter, I'm the mayor of Who-Burg, and we just want to welcome you here today to an exciting time together to meet the Grinch and all the people of Who-Burg and see what's happening in this little town of ours, okay? So what you want you to do is just sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
Living high on Mount Crumpet, above every steeple, was a grouchy Grinch who despised all the people. The Grinch hated Who-Burg, the whole Who-Burg town. He would stand gloating as every Who frowned. The Grinch who lived just south of Who-Burg was gleeful as he tricked, tormented, and lied to the people. The Grinch hated Who-Burg, no matter the season. Now please don't ask why, no one quite knows the reason. It could be that his head wasn't screwed on quite right. It could be, perhaps, that his shoes were too tight. But I think that the most likely reason of all may have been that his heart had been lost in the fall. But whatever the reason, his heart or his shoes, he stood on Mount Crumpet, hating the Who's. The glad, happy Grinch, with his glad, happy grin, stared down at the Who's as they wallowed in sin. For he knew every Who down in Who-Burg below lived deep, deep in darkness, with no light to glow. Some Who's lived in fear, some Who's lived in shame. Day in and day out, life was always the same.
I have them, right where I want them, you see. Believing my lies, they will never be free. Just look over there at Sara Mayhew. She lives to please others, and so she must do everything carefully and with lots of thought to make sure the other Who's like her a lot.
I'm afraid they'll reject me if I don't dress their style, or if I don't pick the same hip bathroom tile. I must clip my toenails just as they do, and shave under my arms with a razor that's blue. I eat wings at the tavern every Monday at 6, and must act like I like all these Who County hicks.
This Sara Mae Who was devoted, you see, to following all social rules to a T. She talked how they talked. She bought what they bought. She walked how they walked and soon thought how they thought. But why does she do this? She isn't a lemming. Her hands were not tied. From where is this stemming? If we look deep inside into Sara Mae's middle, we'll find that she values herself very little. The Grinch has whispered her lies from the start. Sharp cutting words that went straight to her heart. Until the whispers soon sounded like screams, destroying her voice, crushing her dreams.
You're not good enough. You just don't amount. Try much harder or you'll never count. Wear pigtails like Leah, and clothing like Mitzi. Your shoes must be high and your jewelry quite glitzy.
Oh, hey! Wait for me! I'm sure you'll be glad to see that I'm wearing the latest Who fad. Got this fluffer mazoo at the Susquehoo Mall. It's the coolest thing ever, the coolest of all.
Ha ha ha, hee hee hee.
The Grinch laughed with a squeal.
This is only the first course in my tasty meal. For right down the street, if you look, you will find another Who neighbor of much the same kind. Though his woes may be different, the root is the same. He's caught in my trap, ever playing my game. Chip Middlesworth, who's addicted to food, can eat day or night, no matter his mood. Chicken and waffles, Lisa's salsa and chips, and all of that food that goes right to his hips. Taco soup, Wookiee pies, and all of that stuff.
And one of my favorites is marshmallow fluff. Hey, wait a minute. Don't judge me so quick. This habit of eating I can't seem to lick. I eat when I'm angry. I eat when I'm sad. Whether the day's good or whether it's bad. Well, food is the one thing on which I depend. Food is my comfort, and food is my friend. Yet, no matter how much food I consume, there always seems to be plenty of room. For it never does fill me, and it's never enough to satisfy me when I'm trying to stuff this void that's within me, near my stomach, I guess. Or wait, is it my heart that's been causing this mess? No, that can't be right. That's not so. Because I know when I find that one perfect bite, I'll finally be full, filled up to the top. And this stuff in my face, I'll be able to stop.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole. You're a vile one, Mr. Grinch. You have termites in your smile. You have all the tender sweetness of a seasick crocodile, Mr. Grinch. Given the choice between the two of you, I'd take the seasick crocodile. You're a foul one, Mr. Grinch. You're a nasty, wasty skunk. Your heart is full of unwashed socks. Your soul is full of gunk, Mr. Grinch. The three words that best describe you are as follows. and I quote, stink, stank, stunk. You're a rotter, Mr. Grinch. You're the king of sinful sights. Your heart's a dead tomato splotched with moldy purple spots, Mr. Grinch. Your soul is an appalling dump heap, overflowing with the most disgraceful assortment of deplorable rubbish imaginable, mangled up in tangled up knots. You nauseate me, Mr. Grinch, with a nauseous super nos. You're a crooked, jerky jockey, and you drive a crooked hoss, Mr. Grinch. You're a three-decker sauerkraut and toadstool sandwich with arsenic sauce.
I can relax. I can prop up my feet. My work with this who is surely complete. He's perfectly wrapped up in all he devoured. And so that's how he'll spend all of his hours. Let's turn our attention to another who lad. You're gonna love this one. He's always so sad. Poor Bo Finsterbush. So lonely and gloomy. Spends all of his time by himself in his roomie.
Bo would love to spend time with his dad playing sports or watching the game in their Who-Boxer shorts. He hoped for his dad to come home for a dinner, but night after night, his hopes getting thinner. His dad really does love him, wants only the best. So he works, 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 never stopping to rest. His dad's the provider, the man who of the house, thus missing the time with his son and his spouse. But what about mom? He has a mom too. She's lost in the world of her Dr. Phil who. She watches him faithfully every day.
And he always knows just what to say.
She wakes at the crack of 11 each morn. The view is her preference, although she is torn. So many valuable shows not to miss. But no matter her choice, oh, what sweet bliss. To gather such helpful parental advice, or learn where to shop for just the right price. And one can't neglect the health of one's soul, which is why watching Hoopra each day is her goal. All the while little Bo simply misses his mum, the absence of love slowly making him numb. He wonders each day,
is it my fault? Oh, when will these issues come to a halt?
Darker and darker his life is appearing. And up on Mount Crumpet, the Grinch ever sneering. To watch the young lad losing hope by the hour, as his dreams slip away in his room, he does cower.
Oh, the joy that I feel each time I succeed. Squishing and squashing these who's how I need to ruin their lives and to deepen their pain, all for the purpose their souls I may gain. The choices they make, how little they know, entangled in lies, my grasp it will grow. There is no one, no, no one who can compete with the kingdom I'm building right here at my feet. Oh, look, there is Maddie Lou Who over yonder. Where has she been for so long, I must ponder? Did she go to her aunt's? Did she visit her pap? Gee, I don't know, must find out in a snap. I will go on a quest, I will look all around. The answer to this must surely be found. Each who is my business, their business is mine. Once my search is complete, all will be fine.
A note to the Grinch, much has changed in her heart. All of his work in her life is now coming apart. She went to her cousin's for just a short trip, and in one brief moment, the Grinch lost his grip. For a while on her visit to Kalamazoo, Maddie had first heard the news of King Who. Cousin Patty seemed different from all of the rest of the Who's back in Who-Burg, who she knew the best. Patty didn't seem bothered by what others thought. She did not seem to care if they liked her or not. Through each day she went, no matter her part, with a skip in her step and joy in her heart.
How can this be?
Patty thought to herself.
How is it my cousin does not seem to melt at every who's laughter or joking or teasing? Why does she not every who need to be pleasing? She needs no roast deep beast to fill her inside, for the love deep within her she can't seem to hide. And whether with friends or with no friends at all, her being lonely I cannot recall.
Maddie Lou Who, after thinking this through, knew without a question now what she would do. She marched right up to her cousin and said,
Can you please clear up this mess in my head? I don't understand why you don't seem the same. As every who neighbor, I know name by name. What is it that keeps such a peace in your heart when so many others are falling apart?
Then Patty began to explain, oh so sweetly, the day when her life had been changed so completely. She shared how she, too, had once been just the same. As every who friend, Maddie knew name by name.
I was jumping through hoops to make sure others liked me, and trying to fill up my heart that was empty. I was lonely and gloomy and sad through and through, until I was told the good news of King Who. King Who is the reason my life turned around, for once I had gloom and despair, now bound. His peace and his love and his joy in great measure, this gift I won, is...
Maddie and Patty talked on and on of how all the pain in her heart could be gone. Patty shared how King Who, a long time ago, gave all he had because he loved them also. Although he was perfect and no wrong he'd done, he died on the cross for all Who's, everyone. King Who did the hard part, the rest is a cinch. He gave Who's away to be free from the Grinch. It comes down to faith and receiving his gift, simply trusting his care, every who he will lift. Out of the shame and the fear and the lies, he plucks them right out and says, you are my prize. Each who has a choice, and each choice is his own. Each who must respond to the truth he has shown. Then Maddie decided, right then and right there, she would entrust her life to King Who's care. Patty explained right there in the street about this King Who and how they could meet.
King Who is right here. He's everywhere always, in summer and winter and spring and on fall days. He hears all your words and even your thoughts, and he'll talk right on back because he loves us a lot. He thought of you before time began. He created each who with a purpose and a plan. So call out to him. Call out to him now. He'll show you the way and he'll come into your life and he'll show you how. To be free from your burden and all of that stuff. No matter your past, he's quite big enough.
So you see, much has changed in the life of this Who. Her eyes have been opened and changed is her view. As she looks around Who-Burg, she no longer sees those she once passed on the street with such ease. Never giving a thought to the truth they don't know. Never caring one moment where they will go. The effects of the Grinch are very widespread. A battle is raging within each Who's head. Now when she looks, quite broken to her heart, resolved she now is, she must do her part. To rescue them all from the Grinch's cruel plan, the news of King Who she must share through the land.
I must look around here. Who can I tell? Surely someone is needing this freedom as well.
So Maddie looked high, and Maddie looked low. Then she noticed a seesaw that just wouldn't go. Beau Finsterbush was the boy she had found, sitting alone with his gaze on the ground. He was sitting quite lonely, with no friends in sight. Sitting, just sitting, his arms wrapped up tight. Then Maddie walked up and asked the young lad,
Why is your face look so lonely and sad?
But Beau did not answer. He just pulled down his hat, kept his eyes to the ground as he sat. sad set. But Maddie was bound and determined that day that no lack of response would turn her away. She wanted to help him, and help him she would. Whether this day or that, she was sure that she could. And so she decided to sit for a bit. On the end of the seesaw, it's where she did fit. As she climbed on top, right on up he went. And he noticed, at last, a friend had been sent. He lifted just slightly the brim of his cap.
I know.
And suddenly then, his heart started to tap.
I know him.
For never before had any who shown the least bit of interest, such care he'd not known. Seesaw they did, seesawed all the day through. And at the day's end, he no longer felt blue. Though little was talked of that day in the park, light had been shed in the midst of Beau's dark. The next day she came, and the day after that. Day after day they talked, and they sat. Weeks came and went, soon friends they became, and little Beau Finsterbush learned King Who's name. No longer lonely, wherever he goes, through the smile on his face, his happiness shows. King Who's by his side, be it day, be it night. And now Beau, just like Maddie, is sharing his life.
What's going on here? How can this be? Why are they no longer listening to me? My voice is the loudest, quite louder than most. And this is the fact in which I can boast. Yet, now it doesn't seem that my grip's getting weak. It seems like you're hearing another voice speak. I must get to work. I must make it stop. I must not lose more. My plans cannot flop.
Then Sara Mayhew, having just been shopping, didn't feel like her bags. She would soon be a-dropping. So tired was she, both her feet and her soul.
Will I ever fit in? Will I ever be whole?
They'd be harmed. But a fluffer mazoo that came flying their way, this crazy teen who interrupted their play. But sorry for her, they quickly became, when they realized they too had once felt much the same. She sat on the bench, and sobbing was she.
Why are you crying? Oh, what can it be?
Then Sara looked up, and to them she replied,
I am so tired of living this lie. All I'm trying to do is find my new place. but instead I'm caught up in this awful Who race. I'm tired of wearing those shoes that do hurt, and of this glitter that keeps falling off of my skirt. I'm worn out from chasing the latest Who fad. It should make me happy, but I still feel bad.
So Maddie and Beau, this teen did console, and spoke of a way that she could feel whole, without trying so desperately hard to fit in. They told her how she, a new life, could begin.
Who you are is not found in all that you do. It's only based on what King Who says is true. He calls you his child, he loves you so much, and he will bring healing if your life he can touch.
Well, that sounds fantastic. So where do I start?
Just confess with your mouth and believe in your heart.
I choose here and now to follow King Who. I'll trust and obey his words all my life through.
No, not again. This is getting quite old. I cannot afford for these Who's to be bold in their love for King Who. And sharing his light, it's spreading, it's getting too bright. It's time to get forceful, it's time to confront. And Maddie's the one who would take most of the brunt of my wrath and my anger. It's she who began this little crusade to mess up my plan. Oh no, there's Sara now talking to Chip. I must act out now, or from my grasp he will slip. This light is contagious, it's like a disease. I need darkness again, and I need it now, please.
So the Grinch down from Mount Crumpet did fly.
Oh my god.
With a rage in his heart and a glare in his eye, he set out for Maddie, and find her he did.
Oh great, there she is with another Who kid. Hey you, over there, won't you come over here? I'd like to speak with you a moment, my dear. I don't think you realize just what might happen if your sweet little lips you keep on a-flapping. You see, everything is not as it seems. You think people like you, but it's just a dream. Beau's only pretending, and Sara is too. This whole town of Who-Burg is tired of this talk of King Who.
The Grinch towered over her and gave her a wink. Maddie stood there to herself. She did think.
Could this be real? Could this be true? I never imagined. Oh, what should I do? Maybe he's right, this Grinch standing here. Beau did not wave to me when I was near. Perhaps he's angry about what I did share. Perhaps it is true that they don't really care. But wait, I'm not so sure this thinking is right. This small town of Who-Burg is looking so bright. No longer is every Who shameful and lost. Now they are free, and they're no longer tossed. About to and fro, trapped into the dark. It seems to me that this Grinch is missing the mark. And if I recall, I was warned by King Who that this is exactly what this Grinch would do. He said that this Grinch likes to tell sneaky lies, but if you look closely, you'll see through his guise. His real plan is to kill and to steal and destroy every Who man, Who woman, Who girl, and Who boy.
Now that you've had time to think this thing through, I'm sure you've concluded I'm right and it's true. I'm sure you decided it's time now to quit. All this King Who talk, they don't like one bit.
Don't be so sure of yourself, Mr. Grinch. You may think stopping me will be a cinch, but I see through your lies. You're glad I have you, Grinch. And I know you're a mean one, without and within. So I'm sorry to upset you and burst your bubble, but I'd say that your plans for the town are in trouble.
Don't be so hasty or get in a huff. You may think you can stop me, but you're not that tough. I've been playing this game a lot longer than you, and my intentions are surely to see this thing through. King Who cannot have what's been mine from the start. Freedom will not come to these darkened hearts.
You know what, you Grinch? You're a liar and a fake. No longer will you continue to make all these Who's here and Who are given to your lies. The truth will break through and cut you right down the sides. The truth is, if you look around you and see, all these Who's here and Who are finally free. The light shining brightly, there's no hope for you. I command you to leave in the name of King Who.
You may have won this battle, but the war rages on. You might not see me here, but I'm not really gone. In some other Who place, in some other Who town, a door will be opened, and there I'll be found.
Oh.
I know what happened all this year.
So now a town that on the surface looked nice is nice through and through, for King Who paid the price. His gifts been embraced, freedom finally found, his joy and his peace and his love now abound. Still aglow, the light still does shine. There's hope in all Who's, and it's not hard to find. So if you are visiting somewhere that's near, take a quick trip to Who-Burg, for King Who reigns here.
It's our prayer that you've enjoyed your little trip to Who-Burg, but before we leave, we want to just let you in. If you don't know the king that they're talking about, his name is Jesus. And he would be the greatest gift that you can ever have, not just at Christmas time, but any time during the year. For he's the one who gives eternal life. He's the one that gives forgiveness of all of our sins, no matter where we came from, no matter our past, no matter what we've experienced, no matter where we find ourselves in life, whether we're lonely or sad or have nothing at all, it's this King Jesus that we're talking about. So our prayer here, Grace, are that this Christmas you will find King Jesus. Make him your own. Make him your Savior. Make him the one who you will follow every day of your life. And he will promise to take you from this life into eternity. So have a wonderful Christmas. God bless you. And have a great holiday. Have a good night.
Yeah.